everyone.
Good morning.
We have a few announcements today. Happy birthday to David Studemeyer, 28. And Lori Gibson on the 9th. We have two anniversaries to celebrate this week. Russell and Gwen Floyd is on the 5th.
No.
And James and Margaret Rydell on the 9th. We are excited to be back here in our newly painted sanctuary for a worship service, and it is a joy to see everyone here as one. We have the first of 4 1-hour workshops last Monday night, and we'll meet again tomorrow night at 6:30 in the Good Cheer Sunday classroom. The focus of the discussion this week will be on crushing debt, strategies to reduce debt fast. Everyone is welcome to this very interesting and informative class led by Kristen Brett. The Methodist women will meet on Tuesday, August 6th at 10 a.m. in the Prince Fellowship Hall. Pastor Bruce and Carl Paget will travel to Lexington, South Carolina this week to attend Behold 2024, the Global Methodist Church of South Carolina annual gathering. We want to pray for their safe travels. If there's enough interest, we will initiate a 7-session study in September about the Trinity. The study will focus on understanding the Trinity to build deeper intimacy with God. This study targets those who want to explore the foundational doctrine of our faith and enhance their relationship with God. The sign-in sheet is on the table in the narthex. Please sign your name and state of preference for a morning or afternoon class if you are interested in attending this study. Please note in the bulletin below the Sunday service box. There is a line stating that submission of information to be entered into the bulletin or slides is Wednesday at noon. This is to allow Gwen to get everything prepared timely. Does anyone have any other announcements that need to be made at this time?
I do. That's very important about getting things in on Wednesdays for Gwen, okay? Very important. Also, we've got to have 5 books. We need 5 people to sign up so we get the books ordered for that Trinity class. And so please, if you can sign today, or certainly early in the week, please do that, okay? And then I have one here, I got kind of late here, but I made one right there. What it is, I got this, I wasn't able to get that on email, but it says there's a Palmetto Ark of the, Ark of the Palmettos Incorporated wanted me to announce this. If you have a passion for advocating for the rights and inclusion of people with disabilities, experience in leadership, governance, or nonprofits management, experience in areas of finance, fundraising, legal education, healthcare, or community outreach, and a willingness to dedicate time and energy to advancing the mission of Ark of the Palmettos, there's going to be a meeting that's going to be held next Sunday, August 11th, 3 p.m. at the Giving Hope Gardens, okay? And so I want to get that out to people because I think that's an important event that's going to be happening in our community, and I'll be able to give you a printout and stuff after this week and things like that, okay? So worthwhile, fun endeavor. That's okay, that was my announcement. Thank you.
Anyone else? I got one more here. Let's pray for our country's healing and healing throughout the world. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning. Our call to worship prayer is found in Psalm 51, verses 1 through 13, and this is our responsive reading. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquities, and cleanse from me my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge.
Surely I was sinful of her, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desire faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in a secret place.
Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
Do not cast me from your presence, or take away your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, so that sinners will turn back to you. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And we have our invocational prayer today. It's the worshiper's prayer, and so please join me as we pray. Let your continual mercies, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church, and because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Our hymn of adoration this morning is one pulled out from the Baptist hymnal again. And it's an old, there is power in blood, and that certainly suits a request from Pastor Bruce. So please stand as we sing.
Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way, I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions." Yes. Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumblings." While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked toward the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them, at twilight, you will eat meat, and in the morning, you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God." That evening, quail came down and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is this?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, we now move into the time of service where we share our joys and our concerns. Are there any joys or blessings to be shared this morning?
We're in our, back in our church. And everything's working. So far.
Yeah, I was just in despair. I walked in, here and didn't see nobody. I said, "Oh, nobody showed up." There you are, right? Okay. Any other joy to be here? Sure, okay?
We just realized yesterday was our anniversary and we forgot to celebrate.
Okay. Any other joy?
Me.
Uh-huh.
I fell down twice this week, but I didn't get hurt.
Good. Thank you for that. Any other joy to be shared? Yesterday at Sunshine Pancake House, I walked in and there was about 6 African American gentlemen at the table. There was no room. I asked them, could I sit there? They said, "Yeah, sure, we'll pay for your meal." And so we just had about a good hour of fellowship. I mean, it was just like, they were some Christians from Dillon, and they were down, and they just going around fellowshiping around, and it was really good to make some friends. Really was. Really good. Really good. Okay? Any other joy to be shared? Okay, concerns to be lived before the church this morning?
Just keep Mimi in prayer. She's went up there this morning and she's still having problems. But she got a doctor appointment Thursday, and we'll just go from there to see what doctor tells.
Okay, all right. Okay, I heard there was a high school student that was killed in an accident. Has anybody heard about that? Leaving band practice. This happened yesterday. Find out the name on the paper. Have you heard of that?
I just know that he was it.
Yeah, okay. Drunk driving was killed. Okay. Leaving band practice. Yeah, I tell you, those roads are rough. And they realize you got to be careful. It's really sad that happens to a young person like that. Okay. Any other concern?
Diane? People who have the storm.
Right.
Families in Florida right now. This
thing, so. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I haven't heard the latest on that storm, but I was talking to Carol earlier, and we might have to see if that's going to affect our annual conference, because evidently it's coming up this way. And from what I hear, what I've seen, a lot of the rivers are already filling up with water, so, you know. So, at Florida, and then places down here, they get hit all the time, just like this. Okay? Any other one?
My brother-in-law, Rick Greenwell, we would keep his family in prayer. He lost a brother this week. And
okay. Then
Patsy McRae also passed away from Mullins and Charles.
I have another joy.
Okay.
My husband said he was about ready to start coming to church.
Okay. Amen. That's good. Wonderful. Yeah. Okay.
Praise the Lord.
That's good. Okay. Any other joy concern to be shared before the church? Okay, any unspoken requests? Okay, we're going to have a call to prayer. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So we're here to adore you, dear God, and give you thanks for that this morning. And dear Lord, we know this morning as we worship, and our spirits are happy and free in worship. We know that many Christians throughout the world that are suffering persecution, and when they worship, they have to kind of keep every eye open and be alert of the dead with one open and one eye shut. This world is a cruel world, Lord. There's lots of persecution going on. Dear God, there's a lot of things happening to folks, even those who are not Christians, Lord. And they're confused by what's going on in this world. Dear Father, help us as Christians to be steadfast in our faith and realize that in the midst of what we have, the many blessings that we have, that we have a serious obligation to be steadfast and to proclaim the gospel and be faithful and true to that, and to not be distracted by little things, that be focused on what is important. Because the world needs to know about Jesus now more than ever. So dear God, help us to be that light for this world that needs that light so desperately, God, and to be the salt in our community to make the difference in people's lives. Dear God, help us. Help us, dear God, to be faithful and steadfast in this endeavor. Dear Father, we know that we have a lot of people in this community that are hurting in a lot of different ways. Emotionally, bereavements, things not working out in their personal lives. There are people with sicknesses, dear Father. They need to be touched and they need to be healed. And Lord, we pray for divine healing. We believe that that can happen, and we do pray for that. And we're thankful for all that we have, the doctors, nurses, and technology that are able to help our loved ones heal and have a better quality of life. Dear God, help us to put everything completely, totally in your hands, and that your will be done, dear Father. Dear God, we know when we do that, we'll have peace. And that peace will be with us now in our journey through this life and to the next world. Dear God, help us to be there for one another, to not abandon our friends and our loved ones, dear God, and to realize, Lord, that we need each other now more than ever. Dear God, this morning, we're thankful for the young people we have in our service and throughout the community. Dear God, help us take this charge of teaching them the way of Jesus very seriously, because they need role models. They need people to look up to and see faith and grow up to be people, young men and women, of faith themselves, dear Father. Lord, this morning we give our offerings, thankful to you, promising, Lord, to be good stewards of those offerings. All that we give will be to your glory, dear God, to build a church that is a light in this community, dear God, a place of faith, a place of love. Dear God, we promise we'll be good stewards in that endeavor. And now, Lord, we pray as we enter into our service of Holy Communion, that you will be with us in a special way, that we'll be filled and be nourished by your presence and your love. And now, Lord, we all pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
As we forgive those who trespass against us, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We'll now worship the Lord with giving our tithes and offerings. If the ushers would come forward.
Save the one who saves. now have our prayer for illumination together. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, and as the scriptures are read and the word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what we say to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, for our New Testament lesson, we have two scriptures. We are going to start with 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, and then Hebrews 4, 15 through 16. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds we have been healed. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses. We have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So, as we usually always do, we will have a short meditation to help us be focused upon the liturgy of Holy Communion. Just want to talk about a few things this morning about the healing, wonder-working power of Holy Communion. Communion is known by a lot of different names throughout the Christian Church. It's called the Eucharist, which means, if you have an idea what that means, I'm sure some of you know, it means Thanksgiving, okay? Catholic Church uses that a lot, calls it the Eucharist. The Blessed Sacrament, they also call it that. All throughout the book of Acts, communion is called the breaking of the bread. As a matter of fact, every time you turn around, when Christians get together, they were breaking the bread, okay? And then it's called the Lord's Supper, probably one of the most popular paintings in, throughout the Western civilization, maybe even throughout the world, is a picture of the Last Supper, okay? The Lord's Supper is called. And back in the early days of Christianity, it was called the Love Feast. Okay, the Christians were known for that. And I think that we all know that even to this day, Christians enjoy eating together. There's something about that that mellows you out. It's hard to argue with somebody when you're sitting down at the table and you're chewing the food and enjoying that and fellowshipping. And it's a good thing. Christians are, and the people of God have always been a feasting people. Now, eating and remembering things through meals and things like that were all throughout the Bible. The first communion recorded in the Bible took place after Abram returned from rescuing his nephew Lot and Lot's family and his goods. Melchizedek served Abram bread and wine and blessed him. And Abram gave Melchizedek all the tithes of all that he had. Okay, that passage is found in Genesis 14, 18 through 20. And so the Passover meal, it was first celebrated on the night in which the deliverance of the people of God from the servitude of Egypt took place. The Passover experience was symbolic in many different ways. Symbolic of deliverance, the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt, and also as symbolic of our deliverance from sin, as Christ, who was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, tells us in Revelation 13, 8, and that was the atoning work of Jesus. He's the lamb without blemish. In that Passover meal, the Israelites would have the lamb in them that they ate, as well as the blood over them, covered by the blood. There's power in the blood. And the blood on the doorpost represents the blood spilled by Jesus on Calvary for remission of sins, for our salvation. And so, very symbolic there. And the purpose of communion is manifold, but there's a lot of things that you can wrap it all up into being spiritually nourished, spiritual healing, spiritual fellowship. There's something about remembering what Jesus did for us that we should do often that helps us stay connected to him and to each other. Remembering his sacrifice, what he did. You know, Jesus, when he went to the cross, he was in the Garden of Gethsemane, he sweat drops of blood because he knew what he was facing. But he told the Lord, he said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Okay? Communion represents union, fellowship, union with God and with one another. And we're nourished in that. And all that, remembering the sacrifice and being in fellowship with God. we're healed. And especially when it comes to forgiveness. I'm telling you, forgiveness is one of the most healing experience that any of us could have, bar none. To know that God has forgiven us, and that he's taken the sins upon himself, and he's taken it all into himself. And that healing, when we experience that, we want to get it out to other people. Now, you know, I don't know about you, but I know that there have been times in my life when people have hurt me, and I didn't want to have nothing else to do with them. Have you ever felt that before? Said, get away from me. But that's not what Jesus did. Jesus, he wants you to handle it. He knows. He knows what you did to him, and he wants you to handle it. And he wants to be right there with you every step of the way. He forgives you. And then we experience, and we're nourished, and we're healed, and we experience God's grace, that grace. That we know that our salvation was purchased by the blood of Christ on Calvary's tree, and forgiveness of sins, and divine empowerment. And then another thing that is very healing and helps us in our fellowship as we come together and nourishes us is the hope that we have that Jesus died for us. We remember that night. We remember that night. And that's what the Lord's Supper is all about. We're doing the same thing that Jesus was doing with his disciples that night of the Passover meal, the night that before he was about to be crucified, as he served the bread and the wine to the disciples there, even the Judas who was going to betray him, he still loved Judas and wanted Judas to not do that. But we know how the story went. But he'll give us that grace and that love. That's why we have an open table for anyone to come. You don't have to be a member. And we don't need to know where you're at in your relationship with God. You can ask God to forgive you right here and right now. And all of us have to ask God to forgive us and make up our mind we're going to do better. And then another thing in Holy Communion is remember, it's a thanksgiving. So all of that, the memory, understanding forgiveness and God's grace, and hope and thanksgiving is what we experience in Holy Communion. Let me tell you, thankful people are happy people, are loving people, and thankful people can change the world. We can change the world with that hope and with that message of forgiveness. Okay. Now, the attitude that we should have as we come to this table is one of true repentance. We've got to be sure that when we repent, that we are truly sorry for what we've done. Not sorry that we didn't fall. Sorry that we've got to ask for forgiveness, but sorry that we realize our moral bankruptcy before a holy God. Okay? That is what needs to be made right. We have to have that to be made right. Okay? I was asked the other day, coming out of the gym, I saw my friend Kip Jordan, and he shared with me, y'all know Kip. He said he was teaching on Saul and Paul. He said, briefly, just kind of tell me what that's about. And I said, it's about forgiveness. Saul met the Lord, and the Lord laid it on him. That Damascus Road experience, he experienced God's forgiveness, even though he had persecuted Christians. Let me tell you, Paul was the main missionary beside Jesus in the world. And I'm telling you, what Paul had did, he would not be qualified to pass the board of ordained ministry in the church this day and time. So the simple fact is God forgave him and made him a new man. And thank God, that's a wonderful example. But forgiveness, being truly repentant. And then we should take and come boldly before the throne of grace. This passage was read to us, I'm reading it again. And Hebrews says here, Hebrews 14 through 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace and help in time of need. We need to be bold about it. God wants to forgive us. Now we also need to understand that it's important to celebrate our divine inheritance. You know, it doesn't matter how much money you have. It's not about being the richest person in the cemetery. It's about your standing with God and what God has done for you, each and every one of us. No matter what our station in life is, no matter what our successes or what our failures are, okay, We're told here in Romans chapter 8, let me get over here where it starts, okay? Sonship through the Spirit. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, but if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you do not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you receive the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and that children then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified. So our divine inheritance God has given us and teaches us and imparted to us his righteousness. It's not any of our goodness. Our righteousness, as the prophet Isaiah said, is as tattered rags. We're morally bankrupt. That is Christ's righteousness that changes and makes us whole. You know, it said the same Augustine, when he got saved, he heard a little child say, go and read. And he went and he read some scriptures that said, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And he was converted, a changed man. And he lived a pretty rowdy life. But God saved him. He became one of the greatest religious leaders and thinkers of the time in the early church, okay? God gives us his righteousness. And then we have that blessed assurance. We have all the reason in the world to celebrate. Now, we know that song, Blessed Assurance, is one of the most beautiful songs of the Christian church, and I love it dearly. But understand that assurance is a holy and a sacred confidence, a complete confidence. It's unshakable certainty of the truth that Jesus is abiding within our hearts. He is our Savior and Lord. He's my Savior and Lord. As blessed assurance. I had a minister who I thought a lot of back years ago who said, one day I remember, he said, anytime you feel doubt, just say the sentence, say it over and over several times. Jesus saves me now. Jesus saves me. Jesus saves me, you and I, now. Jesus saves me, you and I, now. Whenever you feel doubt, whenever you feel shaky about things, understand that you belong to him, okay? And that will give you healing and wholeness. And God will know the promise and assurance that he will provide you all that you need. Not all that you want, but all that you need. Jehovah Jireh, that is that God will provide. Remember Isaac and Abraham, he did not want to take and sacrifice his son. You know, no father would want to kill his own son. But he was willing to obey God, and God provided a ram for him. And God provided, thousands of years later, Jesus on the cross for us. And the world has never been the same. And that's truly wonderful. So now we will move into our communion service now. We'll have a responsive petition. Let us test and examine our ways and return to the Lord.
Christ, bless us, that all hands and hear of your God.
Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon God while he is near.
Sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit,
a broken and contrite heart, God will not despise. Let us draw near to God and worship at his footstool. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your word. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of thee. Forgive us, we pray. Free us from joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
So the peace of our risen Lord be with you.
The peace of our risen Lord be with you indeed.
Now let us share the passing of the peace and show our love to one another.
that in a little bit. Okay, so we're going to do that in a little bit. Oh, yeah. We're going to turn it
spoke to us through our prophets, to look for that day when justice shall roll down like water and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. When nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate the sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by word and the Spirit. At his ascension, you exalted him to sit and reign with you at your right hand. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said,
Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as the holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly name. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your Holy Church, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one bread of life, we who are many are one by him, Christ, sustained by the bread and the wine of the Spirit Jesus. The bread which we break is the sharing in the body of Christ, our Lord. The cup over which we give thanks is the sharing in the blood of Christ, our Savior. So now, those who will help me come forward, and I will say that what we do is this side will come forward first, then the choir, and then the other side. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he broke the bread. He said, take, eat, this is my body, broken for you, for this in remembrance of me. This is the body of Jesus Christ. And after the supper, he took the juice, the fruit of the vine. He said, take and drink, this is my blood shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the blood of Christ. Thank you.
Oh,
pray together this prayer, this closing prayer.
Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves to others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.